Good morning, everybody, from the parking lot at Dundee United Methodist Church. This is our first church service back here at the building since March, and thank you, everyone, for coming back out here today. My name is Richard Rothrock. I'll be filling in for Pastor Brad today. I'm going to pause for a couple seconds so the Facebook numbers can go down. When Pastor Brad told me I'd be doing the service outside in the parking lot, I began to feel a little bit like Robert Schuller. Do you guys remember Robert Schuller? He had the Crystal Cathedral out in California and this wonderful, beautiful building. Betsy and I actually toured it once, and it was an amazing building. But he started off in the parking lot of a drive-in movie theater, and that's where he and his wife got started. I don't know if that means anything, but anyway. So welcome. Thank you for being here. If you're sitting in the seats, welcome. If you're sitting in your car, welcome. And please tune in. I believe it's FM 91.1, and you can hear me. And if you're on Facebook, welcome. And if you're on Facebook, welcome. I hope. Oh yes, that's right. I wanted to give a special shout out this morning to Pastor Brad and Amy, who are up north this weekend, enjoying some much needed vacation. I hope they're watching online, and I hope they're watching the same way we watched their online services for the last couple months, in our pajamas, sipping coffee. And maybe you did the same thing. So welcome to all of you, wherever you are. And by the way, I know I'm at church because everybody's in the back row. So wherever you are, welcome to you, however you are, however you're dressed. We are all robed today with the love of Jesus. Let us worship him today as one family, one church, and one nation under God. Would you please join me in speaking out loud the gathering that can be found in the bulletin you can download, or Jill is also walking around with copies if you need one. Please join me in the gathering. God is spirit. Let us worship him in spirit and truth. God is truth. Let us worship him in truth with our whole soul. God is soul. Let us worship him with all our heart. And also please join me in the call to worship. Your word is a lamp to put my feet and a light to my path. I have sworn an oath and confirmed it. Serve your righteous ordinances. Accept my offerings of praise, O Lord, and teach me your ordinances. I hold my life in my hand continually, but I do not forget your law. Your decrees are my heritage forever. They are the joy of my heart. I incline my heart to perform your statutes forever to the end. Would you please join us in our first hymn? And I'm not singing today, Betsy.
Oh, I can't tell you how much I've missed this. I hope you have the words and things and you can sing along.
Flow, river, flow, flood thy name.
temporary technical glitch, but we are back. And our next hymn will be Fully Ground. Our second scripture lesson today comes to us from the book of Genesis, chapter 25, verses 19 to 34. This is the account of the family line of Abraham's son, Isaac. Abraham became the father of Isaac, and Isaac was 40 years old when he married Rebekah, daughter of Bethuel the Aramean from Paddan Aram, and sister of Laban the Aramean. Isaac prayed to the Lord on behalf of his wife because she was childless. The Lord answered his prayer, and his wife Rebekah became pregnant. The babies jostled each other within her, and she said, "Why is this happening to me?" So she went to inquire of the Lord. The Lord said to her, "Two nations are in your womb, and two peoples from within you will be separated. One people will be stronger than the other, and the older will serve the younger." When that time came for her to give birth, there were twin boys in her womb. The first to come out was red, and his whole body was like a hairy garment. So they named him Esau. After this, his brother came out with his hand grasping Esau's heel. So he was named Jacob. Isaac was 60 years old when Rebekah gave birth to them. The boys grew up, and Esau became a skillful hunter, a man of the open country, while Jacob was content to stay at home among the tents. Isaac, who had a taste for wild game, loved Esau, but Rebekah loved Jacob. Once, when Jacob was cooking some stew, Esau came in from the open country, famished. He said to Jacob, "Quick, let me have some of that red meat. I'm famished." That is why he was also called Edom. Jacob replied, "First sell me your birthright." "Look, I'm about to die," Esau said. "What good is the birthright to me?" But Jacob said, "Swear to me first." So he swore an oath to him, selling his birthright to Jacob. Then Jacob gave Esau some bread and some lentil stew. He ate and drank, and then got up and left. So Esau despised his birthright. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. When I found out I was going to be delivering this service today in the parking lot, my head immediately flashed back to the first time I was ever at a drive-in movie. Remember drive-in movie theaters? It's great. They're making a big comeback this summer. But they used to be almost extinct. But the first time I got to go to one, my father got it in his head to put us in the car. We were in West Virginia at the time. And we drove an hour to the ABC drive-in in Baden, Pennsylvania. And we were going to see a triple feature. It's the only time in my life I've been to a triple feature. And my mother, always thinking ahead, knew we were going to get back really late. So she made sure my sisters and I were already in our pajamas when we left the house, so that we would be all set for bed when we got back home. And we saw three movies that night. The first one was actually the one I was most jazzed about, and it was Snoopy Come Home. If you remember that one, about Snoopy the dog in the Peanuts universe who wants to just, you know, go about, he wants to go to the beach, he wants to go to the library, he wants to do all these things, except everywhere he goes, he keeps running into this sign, "No dogs allowed." And he has to deal with this, and he finally gets so frustrated about it that he threatens to move away and go live with his original owner. And I won't tell you what happened because I know how people feel about spoiler alerts these days. The second movie was Le Mans, starring Steve McQueen. And Steve McQueen, everybody remember Steve McQueen? He's slipping away in his fame these days. But Steve McQueen played a race car driver named Michael Delaney who was coming back from a bad wreck, and he was trying to win Le Mans. And at one point in the movie, this wife of a former driver looks at him and she says, "When people risk their lives, shouldn't it be for something very important? Why is it so important about driving faster than anyone else?" And Michael Delaney replies, "A lot of people go through life doing things badly. Racing's important to men who do it well." And then this is the line all racing fans quote now. "When you're racing, it's life. Anything that happens before or after is just waiting." And the third movie on the list was actually the one I was most concerned with, because this was going to be my first PG movie. I was moving out of the realm of G to PG, parental guidance suggested. And it was Big Jake, starring John Wayne. Yes, this is the archaic technology of VHS here. I need to upgrade. And John Wayne played Big Jake McCandles, a rich rancher who had forsaken the rich rancher life and was leading a simpler nomadic life with his best friend, a Native American named Sam. But his grandson gets kidnapped, so Big Jake and Sam are called in to get him back. And down toward the end of the movie, they, of course, have to charge into the realm of the kidnappers, and of course they're outnumbered, and of course there's a very good chance that they won't make it. And as they're loading their weapons, ready to go in for the final, John Wayne looks over to Sam, and he says, "Sam, I hear the elk in Montana are as big as buffalo this year. We ought to go hunting when this is over." And Sam says, "I look forward to that." And then he gets this very sad, very contemplative look on his face. And he says simply, "I wish they were buffalo." And Jake sighs and smiles, and he says, yeah, times change. And I'm not going to tell you what happened there either, because that would be a spoiler alert. But it's starring John Wayne, so I think you can guess how it goes. It may seem like all three of these movies are dealing with different subject matters, but in the end, what all the characters in each of these films is dealing with, whether it be Snoopy wanting to go where no dogs are allowed, or Steve McQueen racing at Le Mans, or John Wayne rescuing his grandson, they're all finding and fighting for their birthright. And that is what we also have in our Bible lessons here today. We don't talk about birthrights much these days. They're kind of falling out of fashion. As John Wayne said, times change. But back in Bible days, and frankly, all the way up to around the turn of the 20th century, they were a pretty big deal. Back in the day, the father controlled everything about a family. He controlled his wife. He owned all the property, all the livestock. He dictated what roles his sons would have within the family. And the family operated more like a business than a family. He determined whom his daughters would marry, and they usually had no say in their choice. They'd marry whoever was best for building the brand or expanding the wealth of the family, as they would say today. And the most important thing that a father could pass along was his birthright. Essentially, who would inherit the mantle of family leader? The one thing he could not do was pass it along to a daughter, because women had no standing in the community. I often think of Jethro in the book of Exodus, who lived in the land of Midian with a bevy of daughters but no sons, until Moses came along and married Jethro's daughter, Sephora. Traditionally, the birthright passed down to the oldest son in the family. He would become the new head of the family once the father died and would inherit all his property and all his power within the family and all his standing within the community. And he would also get a double portion of his father's financial wealth. So getting your father's birthright was a pretty big thing. The only guy who seems to have not cared a whit about it is Esau. It is true that Esau and Jacob were twins, but Esau was the firstborn of the two, so the family birthright would still have come down to him. Esau apparently was also a guy who liked to toy with his twin brother. I get the impression in today's story that Esau is free and loose with his birthright because he doesn't believe he can really give it up. He arrogantly believes that his role in the family makes him exalted and untouchable. Certainly his younger brother, even a twin brother, cannot best him. The Bible also makes it clear that Esau does not view Jacob as very manly. Esau is described as a hunter and outdoorsman, a manly man covered in hair, who reeks of strength and virility. Jacob, on the other hand, is described as someone who prefers to hang around the tents, which means he prefers to hang out in the company of women, who, as we've already established, have no standing in this very patriarchal society. The only person who appears to believe in Jacob at this point is his mother. And that is not necessarily a bad thing. Have any of you seen the award-winning documentary, Won't You Be My Neighbor, about Fred Rogers? And Fred Rogers, Mr. Rogers, as we all knew him, liked to take people and sit them down and say, from the time you were very little, you've had people who have smiled you into smiling, people who have talked you into talking, sung you into singing, loved you into loving. They've always cared about you beyond measure and have encouraged you to be true to the best within you. Let's just take a minute of silence to think about all those people now. And when people would do that, and it's very interesting to discover how long 1 minute really is when you actually try and be quiet for a minute with nothing else going on. And when that minute was over, Fred would ask, who did you think of? And 8 times out of 10, the person looking back would think of their mother. So Jacob's in good company when the person who believes in him most is his mother. Rebecca is his co-conspirator even later on when Jacob dresses up like Esau and finishes deception by stealing his father's blessing from Isaac as well. Esau may have been the stronger brother, but Jacob was clearly the smarter. And when Esau discovered he had been double-crossed twice by his younger brother, his anger turned to hatred. Jacob fled to a new land, and Esau spent the rest of his life trying to get revenge against him without success. And rather than learning a lesson from his actions, Esau refused to move on and let that hatred grow until it consumed his life. In many ways, I see parallels between this story of Esau and Jacob and the story of Cain and Abel. Cain and Esau seem to have had very similar personalities and pursuits, as did Abel and Jacob. Both Cain and Esau appear to have everything going for them. They're physically strong. They're good providers to their family and their people. And yet in both stories, it is Abel and Jacob who are the chosen ones of God. The only difference is that Cain does rise up and murder his brother Abel and spends the rest of his life regretting it, while Jacob uses his wits to defeat Esau and triumph over his brother. And from there will come Jacob's son Joseph and the 12 tribes of Israel, which will set up the Hebrew people down through the centuries from generation to generation. Jacob uses his wits and skills, the talents God bestowed on him, to serve God, while Esau used his God-given talents to serve himself. He showed little interest in honoring God or to use them to make the world a better place. Between the time of Jacob and Esau and today, the concept of the birthright has diminished in importance to the point where we barely even think about it anymore. It seems to be something archaic and best consigned to the dustbins of history. Older brothers don't hold as much sway over their siblings as they used to, at least not legally speaking. Women no longer have zero standing and make their way in the world without the help of a man. And in most cases, when a father dies these days, his wealth and property is not passed down to his eldest son, but is distributed equally among all his children, whether they be male or female. But that doesn't mean birthrights do not still exist. They do. But just like everything else, our birthrights have gotten more democratic and more inclusive. Yes, I know. My microphone died. Testing. Here comes Dale. Dale Williams, come on down. We're still on Facebook, though, right? Oh, now.
Hey.
Dale, you just had to get within 25 feet. Testing. Hey. There we go. You have to stand there now for the rest of the service.
I'll get your chair.
And all that. Yeah, you can use my chair.
I'll try again.
Testing. Nope, it's on.
This is
a
chair.
Chief. Well, we can try. It's off. Testing. All right.
Quick.
Yes, quick. Get going. Yeah. Birthrights are no longer dependent on a relationship with our eldest brother. They are now dependent on our own personal relationship with God. Thank you, Dale. In fact, I believe each of us today is blessed with two birthrights. One, our first birthright as Christians is the love of Jesus, the sacrifice he made for each of us up there on the cross to free us from sin and make us born again. Many of us have a hard time embracing that because it's something so rare in this world today. Unconditional love, affection without any limitations, or love without any conditions. The acceptance of you exactly the way you are. That is so hard to accept when we ourselves most often refuse to accept ourselves the way we are. But once you feel the love of Jesus, it is a love that is impossible to forget or to live without. It is a love which enters our body and suffuses everything about us, from our life choices to how we view the world and how we treat our fellow human beings. It is a love that governs our thoughts and guides our actions. For some people, it has been reduced to what they call bumper sticker theology. What would Jesus do? But that doesn't make it any less true. And if more people took that attitude, the world would genuinely be a better place. But I also believe there's a second birthright that God bestows on us, and those are the talents and the abilities he gives each of us to use in each of our lives. It is popular to think that God favors some talents over others, but I believe God views each of these talents as equal and necessary and essential for us to create a productive and balanced society, whatever that talent may be. We see in this, in our second Bible passage this morning, the parable of the sower. God is the farmer sowing the seed among the people, and each tiny seed is the unique talent that he has blessed each of us with. And it is then our responsibility to water that seed and nurture that seed and let it grow. I would often speak about this with my students when I was teaching at MPI, though I would talk about it in more secular and less religious terms. And they would ask me how they could figure out what their unique talents were. Unfortunately, like so many things in life, this is something each of us has to figure out for ourselves. But the hints of what that talent is are usually, does it come naturally to you? Are you happiest when you do it? And when you do it, do you feel connected to the universe or some kind of higher power? Does it feel like you are just a conduit for someone else's thoughts and actions? And does it seem to be coursing through you when you do it? That's what it feels like when you've discovered the talent and the birthright God has bestowed on you. What were you doing when that happened? Like Steve McQueen says in Le Mans, racing is life. Everything before it and after is just waiting. That is also what it feels like when you discover the birthright God has bestowed on you. You know you are doing what you are meant to do. And it doesn't matter how old you are. It is never too old to discover that birthright, that talent, and to share it with the world. I used to say I felt happiest when I wrote, when I taught, and I do regard what I'm doing right now as a form of teaching, and when I'm a parent and a husband. We hear that birthright when my wife Betsy sings, or when Linda plays her music, or when Dale does his radio stuff, and on and on and on. Each of us brings a talent that makes the church behind us stronger. God has blessed each of us with a talent and ability that will make the world a better place. We were born with it. It has been a part of us for so long that we can't even remember when we didn't have it. It is our job as Christians and as humans to figure out what that talent may be, and then to nurture it and let it grow. If we are lucky, we have a teacher or a pastor or some kind of mentor in our life who sees the value in our talents and shows us how to make it grow into a mature crop that we can share with the world. I was always stunned at the end of my school years when I'd have at least two or three students who would come up to me afterwards and thank me for being the first person in their life who ever believed in them. Sometimes what we have to share is not something the contemporary world wants to hear. We are often told what we have to share is not valued by the world, that we can't possibly make a living, we can't possibly make a difference doing that. Jesus said in our passage today that the woes of this life and the deceitfulness of wealth choke the word, making it unfruitful. We seem to be going through one of those phases today where wealth and power are valued above all else. And is the world a better place because of it? I don't think so. We are all here for a purpose. Whether we're sitting in the parking lot here, whether we're listening at the houses across the street, or you're listening online on Facebook, we all have a talent that is our birthright. What is yours? Does it come naturally to you? When are you happiest? And when do you feel like you're connected to a higher power? Are you more like Jacob? Or are you more like Esau? Are you using your talents and the love of Jesus as your birthright to make this world a better place? Or are you allowing them to wither and die on fallow ground? Are you helping people nurture their God-given talents? Or are you holding up a sign that says, "No dogs allowed"? The last couple months have been rough. We've been forced to isolate in our homes. We've missed the life-sustaining things that keep us grounded, like church and dinners and friends and family. We've spent more time sitting around in our pajamas watching movies like a kid at a drive-in theater than at any time in our life. And it often feels like we are no longer in the race of life, but are just waiting and dreaming of a time when the elk in Montana were as big as buffalo. Let's be honest, 2020 has sucked so far. But I'm not giving up on it yet. Many people have died. Many people have lost their jobs. Many people are wondering what they should be doing with the rest of their lives. I'm one of those. If you're one of those, please take a moment this week to lift up your hands and come home to God. Like Fred Rogers said, take a minute to clear your mind and ask, what is my talent? What is my birthright? And how can I use that to make the world a better place? Amen. Now I've got to shuffle through my notes and find the order. Okay. Next up is our prayer concerns. At the moment, I have two prayer concerns. Carly Haller, we have some good news. She is out of the ICU down in Toledo, and she does not have COVID, but she's still in the hospital. So to get back to, and also Shirley Breitner is.
Carly came home this morning.
She did? Oh,
yeah.
All right. Yay. Yeah, Carrie just said Carly came home this morning, so hallelujah, praise God. All right. If you have some prayer concerns of your own, I ask you to take them to God in your heart, and let's have a moment of silence. Dearest God, we come to you today from a place that we have long wished to be at and are finally back to, our place of worship, our spiritual home. For months we've worshiped together online, but alone in our homes. We've missed our friendships, our families, and the simple pleasure of being out and about with our fellow human beings. It's been a horrible year so far, Lord. Across the country, many of us have been sick. Many of us have died, friends and relatives, old and young. Many of us feel we no longer belong in the world we see. It appears the common bonds that bind us together as citizens are coming apart. We no longer see the similarities in other people, we only see the differences. There are days when the weight of the world becomes too much to bear, and we want to shut the world away and do nothing. We lack the ability to see the way forward. Forgive us, O God. Forgive us for failing to see the universal traits that we all share. Forgive us for not reaching out more, for not utilizing the talents you give us, and for not thinking that everyone, including ourselves, has value in this world. Help us to reach out. Help us to focus on what we share rather than what we don't. Help us to accept the unconditional love of Jesus in our life and to pass it on to everyone we encounter. To feel his love and to channel it out to others so that they too can find their talents and find their worth and discover their own role in your kingdom. Take us in your arms, mold us in your image, make us a conduit of your love the same way your son Jesus was, whose prayer he taught us to pray by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. As always, here at Dundee United Methodist Church, we have needs and bills and things to make our church an effective part of the world. We ask you to please continue giving. If you wish to give today, we have some offering plates set up around the parking lot. If you'd like to give online, go to our Facebook page or go to our church page, and you can give there. And in that spirit, I offer up this prayer of dedication. Almighty God, whose patience and love passes all understanding, please accept these offerings as tokens of our love for you. We pledge these funds and we pledge our talents to you. May they make the world a better place both today and tomorrow, now and forever. Amen. I feel, considering the extraordinary setting we're in today, I would be totally remiss if I didn't thank my team for making this happen. I want to thank Linda Plum for her music. I want to thank my wife, Betsy, for her wonderful and incredible voice. Andrea Hickey for making the online internet Facebook working. And I know we went down during it, so she got us back online. Hallelujah. I also want to thank DJ Dale Williams, wherever he is, who also made this possible for me to keep running my hand into this microphone. And also says, and also, wherever, where is she? Jill Bradley.
Where is Jill?
Over there. Who, as far as I can tell, just does what needs to be done to make things happen. And thank you for having that attitude each and every week. And Ed Proctor. Where is Ed? Oh, Ed's in his car. I also want to thank all the people in committees behind the scenes who have been working tirelessly to help us reopen. Please keep, we'll find out what's happening next week. Please check in the website, check on the Facebook page. And I also finally want to thank each of you there, there, and there for joining us here today. Take your love of Christ Jesus, take your strong, resilient faith, and share it with the world. That is how we will make the world a better place, not just for you, but for everyone in the world. Would you please join us in our final hymn today, Let There Be Peace on Earth. Let us pray. We are all robed today in the love of Jesus. We are standing in his presence on holy ground. Feel him in your heart. Let him into your soul. Feel the warmth of his unconditional love and take it in. Let it color your every decision. Use it and your talents to work for God. Let it shine, Jesus, shine. And then let it spread beyond yourself, beyond this building, beyond this parking lot, so that it may be shared with the whole world. Let there be peace on earth, and let it begin with you. Amen. Thank you, everybody.